Well, good morning and happy Sunday, and welcome to worship here at Heritage Bible Church. We just heard a prelude of Solid Rock, and it begins, "My hope is built on nothing less." Well, if you recognize that song, I just want to let you know, a little preview, we're going to have a great message on hope today. So if you know someone that has just kind of allowed hope to fizzle out in their life, give them a quick call or a text and ask them to join in on us today as we talk about hope and where to find real hope. We also have some wonderful songs waiting for you. We're going to begin our worship with To God Be the Glory, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. And then we'll finish our service today with Trust and Obey. We hope you enjoyed today's service. Join me in prayer right now. Father, thank you that we can say without a doubt that our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ and his righteousness. And we pray today that hope would fill all of our hearts for Jesus' sake. Amen. This is our call to worship.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. Vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Great things he hath taught us, great things he hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will he, our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Psalm 119, verses 41 through 48. Wow. Let your mercies come also to me, O Lord, your salvation according to your word. So shall I have an answer for him who reproaches me. For I trust in your word. And take not the word of truth utterly out of my mouth. for I have hoped in your ordinances. So shall I keep your law continually, forever and ever. And I will walk at liberty, for I seek your precepts. I will speak of your testimonies also before kings, and will not be ashamed. And I will delight myself in your commandments, which I love. My hands also I will lift up to your commandments, which I love, and I will meditate on your statutes.
Pray with me, would you please? Father, what a friend we do have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. No matter what's going on in our hearts today, anxieties, worries, concerns, hurts, things from the past or present, or worries and anxieties about the future. Maybe we're having anxieties about our eternity. Whichever the case, I pray for each person hearing this message, this service today, that they would find a friend in Jesus and grow in that relationship with him. We thank you that we can come to you no matter what's going on in our lives. We pray this morning for the love of God to fill our hearts, with hope and peace and love today. And Father, we pray together as we always do. We pray for our leaders. We pray for those in leadership at Sagewood. We pray for our elders of Heritage Bible Church. We lift them to you. These are tough times, Lord. We're kind of isolated from one another, and we really need you to help us keep vibrant in our fellowship. Thank you that we have wonderful people in this church who reach out by phone, by text, by email, by visiting. And we thank you that we have great folks also who love you with all their heart. encourage each person whose life just seems to be a little empty and void today. Watch over them, Lord. Encourage them, we pray, as we pray in unison the Lord's Prayer as we always do. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. And all God's people said, Amen. Well, we're just about halfway through the Olympics. I don't know if you've been watching them, but each year that there's an Olympic game, whether it's summer or winter games, there's always hopefuls. There's always the people we're watching out for, we're keeping an eye out for. And even the reporters accentuate that by highlighting the background and history of how this person diligently, sacrificially gave up a lot of time and energy to prepare for what they're going to be facing at the Olympics. And so they kind of become our country's hopefuls, right? We hope that they're going to win gold. If not gold, then maybe medal or silver or bronze. Well, it's not just in sports that we have those that we hope in. It can kind of drift over to the area of politics. I don't care what side of the aisle you're on, whether right or left or somewhere in between, or none at all, right? The point is, we do have our hopefuls there. And we're hoping that if our person gets into the White House or the position, that things will be much better. There's hope on the horizon. And politicians spend millions of dollars trying to help you and I be convinced that they're the ones that will help us bring hope back into our lives. But it's not just in sports or politics or any other topic or subject. We work in a culture, we live in a culture where we deal with people who are hoping that there is eternal life. They're hoping that they know the way to heaven. They're hoping that they will wake up in heaven. But how do you know that? How do we know that hope is on the horizon? I mean, what is biblical hope after all? Where do we discover this kind of hope? How is it different than the hope we see presented in politics or sports? How do we actually discover hope? My Bible's open to John chapter 14 this morning, and I hope you'll join us because we're going to be talking about how to discover hope. And basically, Jesus tells us we'll discover hope by believing Jesus is the only source. Now, we're in this greater topic, this greater series called Park Bench Questions, where Jesus asks us the questions, and he is wanting to spark a conversation. And in John 14, verse 2, he says this in the New Living Translation. Here's the question. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? Now, on this verse hinges all the hope that we can muster, because Jesus is telling us great things about what he's going to be doing between the time that he leaves the disciples on that night that he was betrayed to this moment in time. But first, let me give us some background of what's happening. Last week, we were there observing in the upper room as we joined Jesus and the disciples that he was washing the disciples' feet, and he's expressing love to them and modeling love to them. This week, chapter 14, we're still in the upper room. Jesus is still talking to the disciples, but now he moves from talking about love to hope. And he's telling them that you're only going to discover hope when you find its source truly in me. So what happens that prompts Jesus to say this? Well, back in chapter 13, we remember that Jesus says that Judas is going to betray him. He doesn't say Judas right blatantly, but he does say one of you are going to betray me. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that he tells the disciples that he's leaving and they can't join him. That's number two, or you could say strike two. And then strike three is the leader of the 12, Peter. Jesus tells him, nose to nose, that Peter, you're going to be the one that denies me three times before the rooster crows the following morning. All three of those things are a confluence in the hearts of the disciples that just send them into anxietyville. I mean, their hearts are beyond troubled. They're beyond anxious. They're really upset. So Jesus says these first words to the disciples, and this is where we get our first point. By faith, we discover hope when Jesus is the source. And our first point is that we discover hope in his person, in Jesus' person. Look at verse 1 of chapter 14 with me. He says, "Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me." Here's the whole point in the matter. As we mentioned, the disciples are in an uproar. They're very anxious. And we've already discussed about the background of what caused them to be anxious. So here's the point. Jesus redirects their anxiety by getting their eyes off their own situation, their own circumstances, and what may or may not happen, to what we need to focus on when our hearts become anxious, when fear begins to rise up. Jesus says, stop being anxious. Stop allowing your heart to be troubled. And that's exactly how the command should be read. Stop letting your heart be troubled. But instead, believe in God. That's the second command. And believe also in me. So by faith, we discover hope in Jesus' person. This is key when it comes to overcoming anxiety and discovering hope in our lives. I don't know about you, but when our kids were younger and they would get afraid at the thunderstorms or things like that, I would always try to redirect them and say, you know, that's just the angels bawling in heaven when you hear the loud thunder. Someone made a strike. And so you kind of make something humorous out of it and you redirect them a little bit to get their minds off of what they think is happening. And that is that their whole world is ending. That's what Jesus does here. He redirects the disciples from focusing on their fears to focusing on him. And beloved, that's what we need to do when fear rises up, when our hearts are troubled. We need to redirect our minds to focus on Jesus rather than focusing on what specifically is happening to us. Because otherwise we will be in turmoil and it's hard to move forward in our walk with Christ if we're not following the leader, but we're following our own fears. Faith replaces fear, and hope only comes when faith is strong in our hearts. The second point that Jesus tells the disciples is that we discover hope in his promises. Now, there are more than three, but we're only going to cover three of the promises when Jesus is displaying why they should discover hope only in him and see him as the only source. He writes, "My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you?" That's the first promise, is that heaven's a real place. It's not just something in a suite by and by or some esoteric concept. It's not where we die and we go into space and we become part of this blob or something. No, heaven's a real place where we are there and He is there, and we can actually see it. We can actually know. Heaven's called a kingdom, a city, an inheritance, and so many other things in the New Testament. It is a place. And that's what Jesus is saying, is the promise is that heaven is a place. Now, how is Jesus actually preparing a residence for us? Is it that He's in overalls and has a tool belt with a hammer? You know, like Tim the Tool Man back in the 90s, that sitcom. Is that what Jesus is doing right now? No. What He meant was, I'm going to prepare a place for you. Is Jesus that night was going to be betrayed. The following day, we know that Jesus was going to hang on the cross. And through His death on the cross, His burial, and His resurrection, that's what He meant by preparing a place. Jesus prepares a place for us by dying for our sins so that we could be placed in a right relationship with God the Father through Jesus Christ. So by grace, through faith, we become a child of God. And Jesus is preparing that place. So during this time, when He's saying this to the disciples, He knows the next day He's going to prepare that place. Well, is His residence then? Is heaven, is it really a place? Well, yeah. It's real because Jesus is going to be there, right? And that's what makes heaven real. Jesus is going to be there. And we're going to see Him and we're going to be with Him. And it's not like we're going to have to make an appointment. We will always have access to Him. We will always see Him. We will always be with Him. And that is far greater than what it was like in the first century when Jesus could only be in one space at one time, like you and I. But now in heaven, He's going to be able, we're all going to be able to see Him. So heaven's a real place. But second of all, here's the second promise. The promise that heaven is a loving place. Look back at verse 3. This is so interesting. And I learned something in my studies this week that I really am excited to share with you. Verse 3. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And again, we've already reiterated this. Is heaven's real because Jesus is going to be here. But this whole idea of receiving, I will receive you to myself, this is a very interesting word. It's a word that means to welcome someone. Now, you think, well, big deal. I mean, but notice this. Jesus is going to be welcoming us when we go to heaven. He's going to be welcoming us. How incredible is that? The moment we close our eyes, we're going to see heaven's a real place, and immediately we're going to see Jesus, and He's going to welcome us. But not only is He going to welcome us, then this word also carries the idea that we find that Jesus talks about in verse 18. He says, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. And then in verse 23 of chapter 14, Jesus says this. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our abode with him. Jesus wants us to be received in the presence of him and the Father and the Holy Spirit right now. In other words, we're going to experience heaven when we die, but Jesus wants to bring heaven to us today. How does he do that? By receiving us when we come to the Lord in our prayers. The same relationship, this is the critical thing. The same relationship that the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit enjoy, Jesus wants to share that with you and me. He wants to receive us into that fellowship, that friendship, that relationship that Jesus has with the Father and the Holy Spirit. That's all wrapped up in that idea of He will receive us to Himself. Yes, it's talking about the sweet by and by in heaven when we get there, and that's hopeful. But now we know that heaven can come to us because we know Jesus receives us. No matter when it is, no matter where we're at, Jesus receives us. We learned this in our study in Hebrews, that He escorts us into the Holy of Holies, where we get to talk to God face to face, if you will. So we find out that Jesus' promises help us discover hope, that heaven's a real place, that heaven's a loving place. But thirdly, here's the third promise, that heaven is an exclusive place. Now, don't lose me here, because this is where some people have a hard time with Christianity. So just bear with me. If you're new to Christianity, or if this is new to you, hold on, let me get through it, and then we'll go from there, okay? Jesus says the path to heaven is knowable. Look at verse 4 of chapter 14. And you know the way where I'm going. In other words, Jesus says, I'm going away, but I'll come back to you. And you know the way that I'm going. In other words, the way to get to heaven is knowable. It's not mysterious. Remember, we started by saying, well, I hope I get to heaven. I hope I know the way to heaven. No, there's no hope as in wishful thinking, as we're sitting next to a wishing well, and we toss a coin in and we say, well, I hope it all works out. I hope it all works out in the wash, or hope it all works out at the end. Beloved, we don't live life that way. We live life with great hope. And His hope tells us that we can know for certain we're going to heaven. He says, you know the way. But Thomas, because he's called Thomas the what? The doubter, right? You guys are good Bible students. That's what I appreciate about you. Thomas the doubter says, but Lord, we don't know where you're going, and how can we know the way? See, he's asking the question that most of us would have asked at that point in time, except Thomas was more verbal, and he was not afraid to ask it. Some of us would probably remain quiet, but he's asking the very question that a lot of us, in fact, the 11 disciples who were left, they were probably all asking the same thing in their minds, but they're too afraid to ask that question. But Jesus says, we can know. But Thomas says, well, how can we know? We don't know the way. Notice what Jesus says. The path to heaven is not only knowable, it's accessible. Look at verses 5 and 6. I'm sorry, verse 6. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man, no one comes to the Father but through me. You say, well, gosh, that's a lot right there. That's exclusive, isn't it? I mean, that seems narrow-minded. I mean, Jesus is not being politically correct. I mean, is he really the only way? That sounds really exclusive. Like he just picks and no one else gets a choice. And it just seems totally unfair. In our politically correct culture, what Jesus just said there, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Our culture would totally lose it and object like crazy on that one. But notice what this scholar says. His name is Matthew Carter, and he writes, Christianity is exclusive, but Christianity is not exclusive because of who is let in. Jesus teaches us anyone may come, John 7:37 and Revelation 22, verse 17. Christianity is exclusive because there's only one way to get in. That's why it's exclusive. Jesus alone draws men and women to himself, to God. He is the way, not just a way. He is the only way. You say, well, how do you know that? Because Jesus uses what is called a universal negative here. He says, I am the way. There is no other way. I am the truth. There is no other truth. I am the life. There is no other life. See, that makes it easy for mankind on one hand, because there's only one way to heaven, and we know that, and we receive Christ. But while it's easy on one hand, it holds us accountable on the other, because now that we're saved, now that we've placed our faith in Christ, now that we know we have the hope of heaven when we die or Christ returns beforehand, we are under obligation. We have a responsibility to go and share that with other people who don't know him or who are uncertain or who are struggling in their hope. This is our responsibility. Now, let me make this real practical for all of us. Let me identify three ways hope can fill and stabilize our soul when our hearts want to fill up with anxiety. Let me share three ways hope can fill our soul when our hearts want to be filled with anxiety. Now, all these points that I'm about to share with you, there's three of them. They all begin with the phrase, when our hearts want to become anxious, believe Jesus is the only. Okay? When our hearts want to become anxious, believe Jesus is the only way to take. So we follow him. He's the only way to take. So no matter what you're facing today as far as needing direction or wisdom, Jesus is the way to take. Follow him. Follow what he did. Study and read what he did in the Gospels, how he handled situations, and then follow his example and his word. And that leads us to the second thing. We need to, when our anxiety wants to fill our hearts, we need to believe Jesus is the only truth to accept. See, there's a lot of things out there in the world that are distracting us, that are claiming to be truth. But when the end, when we follow those things, they're disheartening, discouraging, disappointing, and quite frankly, defeating. Jesus wants us to accept his truth. That's the only truth. And it all begins right here in his word. To study his word, to read his word, and let it become part of us. That's the reason why we are doing these pause on purposes, to let the word of God saturate us. That's why we teach the Word of God on Sunday mornings. That's why whenever you ask me for counsel, I'm going to take us to the Word of God. It's God's truth. And Jesus says we need to accept it and listen to him. Okay, so when anxiety fills our hearts, we need to believe that Jesus is the only way to take, the only truth to accept, and finally, the only life to embrace. We need to abide in him. Now, Jesus picks up this thought about abiding in him in John chapter 15. You can read ahead a little bit on that because we'll be there in about a week or two. But abide means just to remain with him, not to go out looking for something different, not to be distracted with things that are shiny and glittering, but to be focused on him, because only he provides the way, the truth, and the life. In 1866, the director of music of Moody Bible Institute, Daniel Towner, was leading music in Massachusetts when D.L. Moody was giving an evangelistic campaign. And before D.L. Moody got up to speak, he asked people, "How did you get saved? How are you walking in Christ?" And this young man said, "I don't know if I can articulate this correctly, but I just know that I trust and then I obey." Daniel Towner didn't forget that phrase from that young man, and neither have we. We know this phrase because it was written during that time in the 1800s, 1866, that Daniel Towner sat down and wrote these beautiful words that you and I recall. Trust and obey, for there's no other way. To be happy in Jesus, but to trust and obey. Today's park bench question. If Jesus isn't preparing a place for us, if we don't have hope in him, wouldn't he have told us that? See, we discover hope by believing Jesus is our only source. Beloved, go with that thought today. Go with this truth, because God goes with you. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil He doth richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. What we never can prove, the delights of His love, until all on the altar we lay. For the favor He shows and the joy He bestows are for them who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Today's benediction you're just going to enjoy very much. It's from the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 23. The author writes to us, "Let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep His promise." Jesus can be trusted. His person can be trusted. So we believe in God, we believe also in Him. And His promises can be held on to firmly, because He never leaves us nor forsakes us. Heaven's a real place. It's a lovely place. It's an exclusive place. Trust and obey, beloved. God bless you. Have a great week.